implementation, we focus on performance and energy consumption. The main motivation for our work is the growing concern in the HPC community about energy consumption. As we all know, the power dissipation in integrated circuits is becoming an increasing problem, which limits the attainable performance of traditional architectures. And there is also the problem with the large industry hardware related to the electricity cost and the environmental impact. This has motivated a search for new specialized hardware architectures, where FPGAs, which have been around for a long time, are re-emerging as a more energy efficient alternative to other HPC platforms. This is because manufacturers are making big efforts to improve their high level synthesis tools, which allow the designer to generate a circuit implementation by means of a higher language like C++ or OpenCL, and that is the complex development process of traditional FPGA design, which involves the use of low-level hardware description languages. Also, we have the semiconductor industry betting on accelerating applications on FPGAs. The most remarkable examples are AMD recently acquiring Cygnus, which is one of the two major FPGA vendors, and also Intel acquiring Altera in 2015, which is the other major FPGA vendor. We also have FPGAs in the cloud for a few years now. For example, Microsoft, including FPGA to accelerate artificial intelligence applications, and Amazon adding FPGAs to their cloud services. Before moving on to the study, I'm going to briefly describe what FPGAs are, in case there is someone who doesn't know them. These devices can be seen as a middle ground between traditional CPUs and GPUs, which are software programmable, and application-specific integrated circuits, which are essentially hardware. This gives them the flexibility of the software, but with the advantages in efficiency that comes with the hardware. Some characteristics: FPGAs are a spatial architecture in which a program is developed as a logical circuit instead of the traditional flow of retrieving instructions from memory, decoding them, and executing in a sequential fashion. What happens is a real digital circuit is synthesized inside the chip. This provides less overhead and much lower latency and makes them very efficient. Some drawbacks are that they operate at lower operating frequencies. The operating frequency depends on the circuit, but it's around 200 or 500 MHz for high-end devices. And they also provide less raw floating point performance and memory bandwidth than, for example, GPUs. But this gap is narrowing because manufacturers are making big efforts to compete with higher devices than GPUs. Well, essentially, FPGAs are a matrix of configurable logic blocks and also some blocks with fixed functionalities like memories and hardware multipliers. They possess a programmable routing structure that allows to interconnect all these different blocks and several input-output ports to interface the outside world. A basic representation of the configurable logic block is a lookup table, a flip-flop, and as a programmable selector. The lookup table enables to generate different outputs according to the combination of the inputs, and the logic function is determined at the time of the programming. The idea is that combining several of these configurable logic blocks and the fixed blocks, one can develop really complex logic functions and state machines in order to perform a task. Well, moving on to the application. As you well know, numerical algebra is a field that relies on highly optimized or high performance program libraries, such as PLAS, which these operations are many times the most potentially expensive stage from an execution time and energy consumption perspective. And this motivated the constant search for improvement in the performance of these operations. in this work, we propose to evaluate two of the most representative kernels of class, which are MV and JEM, from the point of view of performance and energy efficiency, but also we would like to test the usability and the required knowledge of the underlying hardware that FPGA design requires. Well, the kernels we selected for our evaluation are part of the Vikings libraries, which are a set of higher synthesis libraries, open source, provided for science, which include, among others, mathematics, algebra, statistics, artificial intelligence, etc. And in particular, the British Plus libraries for FPGAs are organized in three levels, which are not to be confused with the level specification of class. The levels are level 1, which are the primitives, level 2, the kernel implementations, and level 3, software APIs. The level 1 consists of parameterizers, C++, higher synthesis implementations, which are which can be categorized into two types, the computation and the data mover modules. The computation modules have streaming interfaces and perform the basic operations of class computations. And the data movers are in charge of extracting the data from external memory and feeding it to the data movers. To the computation modules. The level 2 kernel implementations are implementations examples for hardware and software developers and are based on the L1 primitives. And finally, the level 3 are basically C++ and Python and software APIs that use pre-compiled FPGA images and are intended to software developers who want to accelerate applications using FPGAs without knowledge of hardware design. In this work, we focused on the L2 kernels. These implementations share the same top-level architecture. They are basically an instruction decoder that retrieves the instruction from memory. The computation block, which can be any of the last implementations or even more than one, and also a timer for profiling capabilities. Well, the kernels we evaluated are JEM Basic. Is a JEM implementation which makes use of those primitives, which are a historic array of 16x16. Data movers, which are in charge of retrieving the matrix blocks from memory and feed to the historic array. And transpose modules, because one of the matrix must be transposed before entering the historic array. And it also acts as a memory buffer. Then we have the JEM multiple compute units. This is basically two parallel instances of the basic version, in which each instance operates individually in parallel with its own memory interface. Then we have the JEM basic, which is very similar to the JEM basic, but with different primitives. And JEM B screening, which is a different architecture from the others. In this case, we have 16 parallel compute blocks, each one with an independent memory interface. This version was specifically developed for FPGAs with multiple channels of type 1 compute. Finally, to gain some perspective on the BITS implementations, we added a state-of-the-art implementation of JEM, which was developed by ETH Zurich, which is also based on a historic array architecture, but it is highly optimized for data reuse and to maximize performance. This was developed for matrix-matrix multiplication, but since we couldn't find an efficient JEM-B implementation out there, we use it also as a JEM-B kernel, like reducing one of the matrices to size 1. Well, moving on to the empirical study, these are the two platforms that we used. First, we have a Xilinx and LV50 data center accelerator card, which is based on the UltraScale Plus architecture. The number of logic elements and RAM and hardware pairs is considerably high because it's a data center Intel card, but among the other HPC FPGAs out there, it's relatively on the smaller side. And it also has 8 GB of high memory. The CPU we use is a Xeon Silver from Intel, which has 8 cores and operates at 2.1 GHz. And it's in a system with 48 GB of RAM. And for the CPU kernels, we use the Intel MKL. For the power measurements, the FPGA card has onboard current and voltage sensor, which are then transferred to the host machine via the Xilinx runtime driver. And for the Intel processor, we use a RAPL to measure processor and memory power consumption. I forgot to mention that all the kernel implementations are on single precision. Well, here are the results for GEM. On the left, we have the performance in gigaflops, and on the right, the energy efficiency on gigaflops or what. As you can see, the GPU, CPU in green is the best performing kernel for all the test cases. Sorry, the test cases are matrix, square matrices from 128 to 8000 columns. Then the FPGA basic version is not that competitive, and the other two are similar, but the MMM implementation is better for the bigger matrices. There is a slight decrease in performance in the GEM MCU from Vitis. This result is maybe due to some, we have to further study this, but we think it's because at compilation time there are some loop carry dependencies issues that prevent some parts of the code to be fully parallelized. If we move to the energy efficiency, we can see that even when the CPU achieves the best performance, the FPGA is most has better energy efficiency for the bigger matrices. This is because, of course, the FPGA consumes considerably lower power. Then about the GEM3 results. Now again, the CPU in green is the one that achieves better performance for most of the cases. Here it peaks at 1,000 columns and then decreases. This is reasonable because of the use of the cache memory. But some remarkable result here is that the GEM3 streaming version outperforms the CPU for the two largest cases, and the other versions are performance. If you look at the energy efficiency, we can see that the trend is maintained and the FPGA is more energy efficiency for the three largest cases. Well, to conclude, we explored the use of FPGAs and calibrated synthesis to evaluate gas kernels, in particular GEM and GEM3. And we found that most of the time the CPU outperforms the FPGA, but the FPGA is more energy efficient, especially for the bigger matrices. In particular, we found that the GEM MMM version of the kernels achieves 1.7 to 1.9 times more energy efficiency than the CPU, and in the GEM3, the streaming variant is 2.9 to 3.6 times more energy efficient. This is a good result because, of course, of the importance of the energy efficiency in HPC, but also if we consider the longer years of development that CPU libraries have, and these FPGA libraries are relatively new, this means that in the future there is more room to improve. And sometimes in future work, we plan to extend our evaluation to other FPGA platforms. Particularly, we want to try the Intel FPGAs and also more class implementations. It would be interesting to add other heterogeneous platforms for comparisons, for example, GPUs. And also, it would be interesting to include different metrics, such as the learning curve of FPGA design, the design time, the price, which are not mentioned here, but are a bit. Every of these aspects is a bit worse than software traditional design.